For it to make sense, you need to understand some of the history behind it. So I'm going to run through this presentation at a good clip, and then because everyone will want to break off for food after this, I'm going to suggest that for Q&A and questions and so on, I highly encourage them, but I'll be around for today and tomorrow, so please just come on up to me and let's do a one-on-one chat on any of the questions. Okay, so it all started in Ireland. Dairy farmer's son, didn't like farming in the rain, wasn't very good at it, and didn't really fit in at home or at school, I wasn't sure why. And at 9, I was given an IQ test, and I found out why. And I started meeting other gifted children, and I started studying and understanding what happens when your IQ is high, but your EQ is low. Your emotional quotient, social skills, common sense, it goes by many names. But just like if someone's blind or deaf, you're strong in one area, you compensate, or weak in one area, you compensate in another. And I started kind of studying not IQ, but EQ, and understanding the importance of that, especially to end up in public speaking situations or social situations like this conference, which I would consider a very high EQ situation. I got into computers at a young age. I was left-brained. They were left-brained. We got along well. As I got busy, I started hiring other prodigies. And the good news is they were very good at what they do, very loyal. They didn't make many mistakes. But if you put two of them on the same project, they will try and kill each other. And they will frequently insult the customers because they have no idea what the word appropriate means. Do not ask one of my guys if you look fat in those jeans. So with extreme talent comes extreme issues, except for Howard's customers. I was a curious kid, so some of you have seen the press on this, but I poked around the ARPANET before the internet and found some cool pictures that I shouldn't have. Then I worked with the Bank of England a little bit on SWIFT, the protocol for all bank wires and transfers, and ended up cracking the encryption on it 16 times and being paid to not try a 17th time. I was a national programming champion and then competed in the World Olympics in programming and went to Sussex University down near Brighton for degrees in artificial intelligence and computer science. Then as I started working and people gave me bigger and bigger problems, I started ending up getting more and more attention. And it just kind of slowly grew over time. To me, these were all just more complicated technical problems. And sometimes people looking at what we do wonder, you know, how can you work in all these different industries, in aerospace and military and so on, and healthcare? And to me, they're not different industries, they're just different data in the same system. And it's all just data to me. And I can manipulate data pretty successfully. So I decided that all the technology I was accessing and using in Ireland was at least 4 years old, because by the time it got developed in Silicon Valley, commercialized, sold across the US, and then they went international, released it in the UK, and then eventually it leaked back to Ireland, everything I saw was 4 years old. So I decided, let's head over to the States and go to the root of the innovation, Silicon Valley. And being Irish, I needed a green card to get over there. I didn't have any family or anyone there to sponsor me. So I applied for the EB-1-1 visa, Extraordinary Ability Visa, Class 1-1. And that apparently is the same visa they give to Albert Einstein and Winston Churchill. And was granted that after a couple of years due diligence by Homeland Security on everything I just told you. So now we run Scorpion as a virtual organization over in, I'm basically based in Los Angeles. I moved down for the weather again from Silicon Valley. And let's go inside here and see that some of the customers now that we solve problems for and we have worked with are well-known and global. And this is started with all technical stuff. This was supply chain management, shop floor planning, manufacturing, optimization of inventory. Things that sound very, very non-glamorous, but I enjoyed I'm an optimizer. I enjoy looking at something and trying to get the absolute optimal out of it. So we started solving bigger problems, mitigating more risk, and I reached that part of Maslow's hierarchy of needs where you figure you're not trying to survive anymore or pay the rent, you've reached self-actualization. Why am I here and what's my purpose? And more to come on that, but in general, the answer is to use my gifts and skills to the best of my ability to do the most good before I die. And for me, my ability was intelligence and treating it as a precious commodity, just like gold or silver. I would mine it from the planet, so find it wherever I could, gather it together, and lease it out to those in need, to run what I call a sustainable home for the mentally enabled, an orphanage for smart people, if you like. So how do you find geniuses? We looked at 10,000 school reports, and we looked for patterns of A's and F's. If it's all A's, it tends to be that they have a tiger mom. But if it's A's and F's, prodigies are extreme. They will turn on and off their intelligence depending on whether they like the subject or the teacher. And there's no middle ground. Mega Menses for folks to score over 180 IQ. The Olympics and other competitions I had done, we reach out to the top 10 people that score well in those. IQ is hereditary, so we use a genealogist to lay out the entire family tree when we find one, and we test the cousins, brothers, fathers, etc., to see if we can find a few more when we found a cluster. We also have a number of fake banks in Europe that once they're hacked into, and we have various types of encryption and mathematics it takes to get through them, you get onto their network, consists of a single Word document, which is a job offer with our security team. And not everyone makes it. I consider what I do similar to saying if I had to form a basketball team tomorrow, saying that the only people I'll interview are those over 7 feet tall is a good start, but it doesn't mean everyone over 7 feet tall is a good basketball player. And it's the same with IQ. It's not everything by a long shot, but it's a good start. And on average, when we bring folks in on probation, put them through therapy, we have 7 therapy courses to raise their EQ, it means they have to be self-aware, they have to be honest, they have to be open with themselves and willing to change themselves. It's one thing to be smart, it's another thing to be smart enough to change yourself, so this time next year you're a different person with a different set of judgment. And about 30% of them flake out of that. They cannot get out of the rut they're stuck in, and they cannot get out of their own way. And when we let them know that they're not going to make the cut, it's devastating for them because it's literally like going back to jail, meaning they're being released into the wild. And with their social skills, they would rarely be able to hold down a job at McDonald's. Now that I've found a few geniuses, the next question is, how do I keep them? So I, like any engineer, I studied the problem and said, okay, why do smart people quit jobs? And hopefully a few people in this audience will be able to relate to this. Number one, complaint. My boss is an idiot and he won't listen to me. So we try to stack the deck and have people report to people with higher IQ than themselves. So whether they like their boss or not, he's not an idiot. Secondly, people get very bored. So in our company, we have the most diverse projects in the world, similar to the kind of requests we heard earlier. And we try to put our folks on at least 3 projects at the same time that have nothing to do with each other. And that tends to do a lot of context switching for them, which is very healthy and refreshing for their brains. From a stability point of view, again, smart people like stability. And when you are in an organization and get laid off on a Friday evening and you just lost 100% of your income, you have to go home to your wife and family and deal with the mortgage and analyze your runway based on your savings, it is not a fun thing to go through. And on average now, you know, the idea of a career for life and then get a gold watch when you retire hasn't been true for a while. I think the average length of time now in an executive position is about 2.5-3 years before you have to update your resume again. So in our organization, at least as you work with us, you're on 3 projects. So if one of them ends, stops, or runs out of funding, you lose 33% of your income for roughly about a month, and then you pick up another gig. So that's a little easier to deal with. The next problem is people who feel unappreciated. And by that, it would mean, for example, someone comes and works on a project with 2 other people. And at the end of the project, they realize that they did half the work, and the others didn't pull their weight. Fairness is a big deal to prodigies. So what we do is we have a fairness algorithm. We quantify and track everything that's going on. So if you came to me and said, the other guys didn't pull their weight, we would look at your work, we'd look at the lines of code you checked in, we'd look at your bug rate and quality, and we'd come back and go, yeah, you're right. You did half the work and they didn't. Which means I have been minus 16% unfair to you and plus 8% overfair to the others because you all got paid 33 1/3. You now automatically get a 16% raise on the same number of hours on the next project. So I've now load balanced your unfairness through zero over time. I'm being as fair to you as I can possibly be in an unfair world by tallying it up and paying it back later. As silly as that may sound to some of you, that matters a lot to the folks I work with because they don't want to build up a grudge over time. They like to be at zero fairness as quickly as possible. And finally, since they're not very well-rounded, but the healthy ones want to become that way, I realize that even though they have high IQ and low EQ, and I raise the EQ up as much as I can, it only gets to about halfway, maybe average at best. They're not going to be the salespeople, the account managers, the concierges, ever. They'll never have that ability. So we did the opposite. We went out and found people with high EQ who have a reasonable IQ, and we call them the super nannies. The super nannies babysit the geniuses and the customers. And it's a very interesting dynamic to watch how they interact and how they respect each other, even though each of them are smarter than the other in different ways. But they need each other. So it's a dysfunctional family that's kind of stuck together. So now that we've discussed that, let's go inside of some of the technologies that we use. So we developed a lot of image recognition and video analysis software similar to the kinds of technology used in situations like the Boston bombing. So for example, when this happened, they had collected 4,000 hours of video footage from various sources, ATMs, video cameras, cell phones, etc. The first thing they needed to do, if they didn't want to spend months watching it, was to use an algorithm that we call the Detect Nothing algorithm. And what it does is it changes the video that you see on the left here to objects you see on the right. And it tracks within a threshold if any of these objects have moved or done anything significant. So in most of the footage, you're going to have people standing there in the wind, waving back and forth 2 or 3 inches, not walking around, not moving, nobody's doing anything interesting. By deleting all the footage where nothing happens, you can now quickly narrow it down to the stuff worth watching, about 14 to 20 hours of stuff where something actually happened. With that, you then use image recognition technology and facial recognition technology not to recognize the faces, but to find the heads. Once you find the heads, you put a red spot on everyone's head. Imagine in this room, we did that right now. And then over frames of video, we track where that red spot moves. If you get up and go to the bathroom or walk out, there'll be a red line across the room. So when you do that for a group of people, you get to track herd think and herd behavior. So if an incident like this happens, everyone's red spot will go down because they were surprised. They'll get up, and they'll generally all start running in the same direction. So if one red line moved early, didn't go down, or started walking in the wrong direction, that is what we call an OOI, an object of interest or a suspicious behavior. And the FBI reported this is exactly what happened in the Boston bombing case. Other OOIs, if you are at a train station or an airport, you want to make sure people don't walk the wrong way in the airport exit, where they start coming in instead of going out, or an object is left at a train station or by a railway track for more than 5 minutes, or cars make more than 3 U-turns, the same car in front of an embassy overseas. That can be an indication of a car bombing. Maybe people can walk past your building or your office, but if they hang out there for more than 15 minutes without moving away from that area, that's loitering, and you may not be comfortable with that. So this whole area is called intelligent surveillance, because having a security guard sit there for 20 years watching a screen and going snowblind, looking at it, is not as effective as a computer that can wake them up saying an OOI has occurred. Another interesting usage of that was police authorities came to us and said we have bubble cams on helicopters for Northern California, and we would like to be able to detect marijuana fields. So we looked at this, we looked at the type of shape of the fields, that didn't help. We looked at much footage and looked at the shades of green. There was too many false positives. Everything was the same shade of green. I wasn't that familiar with how to grow marijuana, so we did a little more research on it. Surprisingly, some of my guys knew stuff without having to research it. And they gave me the responses on the spot. And apparently, to grow marijuana, you need micro-irrigation. You need little bits of water pipes going to each area. So we went ahead and I said, let's use thermal cameras and let's detect the irrigation system. And that narrowed down the problem, as you see here, where now it's either a strawberry field or marijuana, and there's not that much strawberries growing in Northern California. So let's go out of there. So now we're just starting to fly around the world to see some of the areas that we've had an impact. In Baghdad, Global Hawk drones use surveillance systems to look for objects of interest, like this gentleman who left one city about 20 miles from another with a large backpack on, entered the second city with no backpack on. And then when we looked at the footage in between, we saw two white pixels moving in the desert in parallel. Those were his hands on a spade digging a hole next to the road to plant an IED. So we notified the authorities, he got picked up, we tracked the GPS location of where he was digging and defused the IED before anyone got hurt. We have 177 inventions in the company that we lease out to our customers as needed. We used to explain them all, but it took too long, and we decided to change it to, you tell us what you need and we'll tell you what we have. SenGen is one of those technologies. It won the Most Innovative Product Award in aerospace and security. And what it is, without boring you to death, is two chess computers playing each other. And they can rapidly and exhaustively play every possible game of chess, every possible move. From that, we abstracted the rules of chess into a modeling language. So now we can model anything, a divorce, a partnership, a casino game, security, all entry points of this hotel, anything, put it in there, and it will go ahead and generate every possibility that can happen. And it does it at a speed of 250 human years every 90 minutes. So it's extremely faster than human. So one of the applications for that was the U.S. Naval Command and Control System to avoid friendly fire incidents so that they don't end up, again, because of the 3% human error, end up shooting their own allies or misappropriating their own assets. Another use of a system like this was in Afghanistan, applied to mission planning, where you try to plan ahead on if they did this, we'll do that, and if we do this, they might do that. So what we did is I got the Afghan briefing, and I started laying out all the pieces of that I learned about Afghanistan as a game of chess. The good guys, the bad guys, the good guys' transportation, the bad guys' transportation, the infrastructure we're trying to protect, the infrastructure they're trying to protect, the things we can do, like protection and patrolling and so on, the things they can do, like biological contamination and attacking and kidnappings. And SenGen generated every possibility that could happen. One of those possibilities we then presented back to the Rear Admiral, and I'll walk you through it right now. We had a Global Hawk drone flying in the area, and a terrorist insurgent cell decided to hack the IP network. They ended up disrupting the communications, and the drone came down and crashed. And it crashed into a poppy field. And for those that don't know, the poppy fields are the source of the drug money to fund the terrorist activities in Afghanistan. So that's their infrastructure they're trying to protect. Standard operating procedure meant we headed out with Humvees to go retrieve the top secret hardware and followed standard operating procedure that if you find a poppy field, burn it down. Drug lord wasn't too happy about that. So he decided to put arsenic in the water supply to the base, which had about 400 people in that base. And we presented this to Rear Admiral. We said, are you prepared for this? He said, absolutely not. So he said, we'd suggest a shutoff valve with an arsenic detector and a reservoir spare water supply. And that's what they went ahead and did. And then we forgot about this till 3 months later. We got a signal arsenic detector got triggered and switched over to water supply. So otherwise, everyone in that base would have been dead in about 2 days. So then they went ahead and responded. So now we reach kind of the midpoint of my presentation. We have now worked on some of the biggest problems in the world successfully. reduced human error using SendGen, and ended up with a lot of private clients, family offices, and high net worth individuals that either needed technical help or got hacked or were worried about their security or other requests that they had. We also had developed a standard skill set of people we trust. We've been doing this 25 years now. So we have commanders and generals in place underneath me that know how to work with the super nannies, how to work with the geniuses, and I have what I call known entities. By the time I've done my third or fourth project with someone, I know they're reliable, I know they're good. So we are organized intelligence with an ability to execute. And we provide the most uncommon of things these days, which is common sense. What we do is approach a problem in the classic way software is approached, from defining and reframing the problem, breaking down into small tasks, managing it every 2 weeks and reporting back where we're at, and budgeting appropriately. So what's my next act? Now that I've done all of that, where do we go from here? So I started thinking about this, and I had become a reasonably busy person running this organization. We were now 20 countries, 2,600 consultants in our consortium, or experts we can pull on, and hundreds of projects. So I was a pretty busy person, and I visualized what my busy person life looked like. And to me, what it looked like was the following, and I'd say this is true of most people in this room as well. I have a core competency, the green area at the top, which is something that you're all better at than I'll ever be. And at the bottom, you have well-defined tasks, things you can give to your secretary or assistant to go get you tickets or book you a flight to get here. But in the middle, this blue area of the triangle, you have wish list, to-do list, bucket list items that have been on your to-do list for the last 2 years. You're not even getting close to them. You're deluding yourself that they won't be there 2 years from now. You don't know what they cost. You don't even know if they're feasible. You can't give them to your secretary or assistant because you haven't defined them yourself yet. And you need someone with at least your amount of common sense, intelligence, Rolodex, and abilities to call around, Google it, negotiate, talk to vendors, and flesh it out and see, is this a good idea or a horrible idea, and is it doable? As engineers and scientists, what it took me this long to realize is we are classically trained to turn ambiguity into absolute. You give me a fuzzy problem, I'll break it down into ones and zeros. So we decided that to relate this to a concierge service, where normally you concierge down things that are too simple to do yourself, what if you could concierge up things that are too complicated or you don't have enough time to do yourself? And we mean anything, any funded need. So we started doing that for high net worth clients, and it worked. And it worked really well, and we're constantly surprised at how well it works to take software engineers and scientists and point them at non-science and software engineer type problems. So let's look at some of the requests we've had for concierge up. So here in Libya, someone had their daughter was a budding journalist student, decided to run away and cover the troubles in Libya, got captured and put in prison as an activist. The family went over from Beverly Hills to bail her out. There's no bail system for activists in Libya, and she has to wait for her day in court, which is a 2-year waiting list. That seemed unfair, according to my fairness algorithm. The family came to us and said, we would like our daughter home. That is our funded wish. 48 hours later, she was home. We arranged a forced extraction through private military partners of ours. The next request, to avoid the same thing happening, please GPS tag all my kids. Some people want to do that in their shoes. Some people want to do that with medical implants that can't be removed. That was Dubai. We'll now fly to Mexico, where a family is dealing with that they were friends with the ex-president, and the new president doesn't like that, so he raids their offices every 2 weeks, and they cannot get business done. So they wanted a vault on the moon. I mean, they wanted all their business and data to be run virtually in the cloud, shattered where it's spread among different companies in different continents around the Earth, which means you cannot subpoena the data without subpoenaing every country simultaneously, and even then you just have encrypted jigsaw puzzle pieces. So it may as well be a vault on the moon. Nobody can ever see their data again. Again, very useful for family office histories when you want to keep your photos and your videos and everything private for the next 100 years and still viewable when all the video formats and cameras have changed. One of my favorite ones. How do we pick winning racehorses based on their DNA? So we went down to the racetrack, and I realized that this sport of kings doesn't plug a laptop into a horse, the same as they do when a Formula One car pulls over and you pull telemetry data. So I said, what if we did? What if you got me everything? Lung capacity, heart capacity, adrenaline storage, temperature of the horse, nutrition, the length of its legs, the ratio of that to its torso. Put an iPhone on its back and measure its spine alignment based on the pressure pads in the hooves as it runs. And then come up with two ways of measuring a horse's IQ, because a smart horse is a good horse. That one took us a moment to figure out, and then we did. For anyone who's curious in that teaser, come up to me afterwards. I'll tell you how we measure a horse's IQ. We then used statistical regression algorithms that we used in the credit card industry that banks use for a very technical term called separating the goodies from the baddies, where you want to know these 1,000 people paid back their credit card, these 1,000 didn't, what do they have in common? So we did the same thing with 7 years of losers and 7 years of winners at the horses to find out what all the winners had in common. And then we applied that, and we've entered 4 races, we've won 4 races, and any money I didn't make on margin, I made betting on horses to place. Put a shark tank in my office on the 32nd floor of a building in Manhattan, in New York. A lot of work with permits there. I'm building a casino in Vietnam. Handle it. Everything from the gaming licenses, the local authorities, employment rules, to how often the pool boy comes to clean the pool. Because this high net worth individual was building 3 other large real estate projects, and this was his smallest one. I want to make a documentary movie about my life or about the charity that I support. Figure it out, get the right people, make it happen. I want to choose the right race car for my personality. This one comes up very often, actually, because where else do you go? Anyone else you go to is going to sell you the car that they sell. But I believe cars should match their owners just like pets. So having an independent discussion about what is the right solution, whether you want to be flashy, not flashy, you want to be stealth mode, you want to get an old pickup truck and have it be faster than a Ferrari, whatever your wish. One of my favorites, my son fell in love with a Ukrainian gold digger. I cannot interfere in his life or appear to interfere in his life, but I don't want them getting married. Figure it out. And again, the funny part of this is I pull a bunch of scientists together in a room with a whiteboard, and we approach this the same way as we did any other project. Put all the variables out there, start playing chess with it. What can we do? So I'll walk you through this story since we're doing well on time. In this case, what we did was we analyzed, we got gathered intel on the son. The son now made a new friend who had an overbearing billionaire in Europe as well. The new friend likes the same cars, the same clothes, the same music, and the same clubs as this billionaire's son, and they fast become friends. We find out that his Ukrainian girlfriend likes to go to Starbucks every morning. So the first morning that she goes, we have another Ukrainian girl wearing the same type of stilettos, 2 places in front of her in line. They don't say a word to each other, but she's on the cell phone speaking her native tongue. The next day, that same girl in a different set of shoes is standing a couple of places behind her in line, talking away on the cell phone, and again, they never meet. The third day she goes to Starbucks. The Starbucks is rented out and filled with extras, movie extras, so there's only one seat available right opposite the other Ukrainian girl who's wearing a wire. They get together, they sit down, they talk, they bond. Eventually, the Ukrainian girl, who's our target, says that, yes, she's dating a billionaire's son. She's going to marry him without a prenup. She's going to, while she's on the honeymoon, she'll be filing her green card. She will then go ahead and file for divorce soon after her return and use the money to bring her real boyfriend over to the States, who's waiting in the Ukraine. Now, when I had that recording, it's inadmissible in court. It's no use to the father because he already knew. That's why he hired us. And I can't show it to the son because the son is not supposed to know we're interfering. So it was only for me because, again, I have to check with my fairness algorithm that what I'm doing is correct. and this lady had just fallen on the wrong side of my fairness algorithm. So then we have a double psychologist, double PhD psychologist on staff, who wrote a speech for the father on how to say all the wrong things to the son and push his buttons. We used an acting coach to rehearse this speech for the father and then texted him on a Thursday night and said, now. And he went in and delivered this rant to the son, completely ticking off the son. The son calls his new friend to complain. The new friend does, I'd say, subliminal messaging, but it's not so subliminal. And says, I would love to help. That's a horrible thing to happen, but I'm going to the Dominican Republic in a private jet tomorrow for a friend of mine who's getting married. The other son said, that's it, perfect. I'm going to take my Ukrainian girlfriend, jump on the jet, fly with you, and we'll get married without a prenup in the Dominican Republic. That'll show my father. So that's what they did. They got married by the same priest who was marrying the first couple in the wedding. She went on a honeymoon, did file for her green card, got confirmation it was on the way, and it came back, and soon after filed for divorce. We welcomed her to our law offices to give her her divorce settlement. It was the first meeting she'd ever been on time to. And we presented her with a contract. She read the contract and said, this is an acting contract. I said, yes, do you recognize the name on it? She looks at it and she turns white and says, that was the priest who married us. I said, yes. So here is your letter from INS banning you for 10 years for INS fraud from the States because you applied for a marriage green card. You're not married. Here is your one-way ticket back to Ukraine. Here's your Dear John letter to your husband that's already been written in your handwriting. Just sign here. And here's your gag order to never talk to him again. And we took her from the office straight to the airport. Son was relieved that he got out of his divorce that he had been announced to him. And he's bonding with his father now because his father never interfered. So it was a six-month movie without any cameras. I want to build a command center to control all my businesses. I just want to be happy. I want someone to sit down with me, study and research happiness, explain it, quantify it, and define a happiness infrastructure as to what that means to them. Help my business not need me anymore without the business collapsing. How do I get out of this empire I've built so that it doesn't need me? How do I replace myself? I want a hidden room in my house that's undetectable and doubles as a panic room for my family. The last couple of examples here. And what happens is people will hire us to fix a problem, and they come back and go, that was quite nice, that worked well. Can you fix my life? Can you fix my family? Can you fix my business? And if they're royalty, can you fix my country? We've had that happen three times. This one lady, her father passed away and she just inherited a whole bunch of businesses and a newspaper publishing empire. And everyone under her had started fighting, quitting, suing her, suing each other. It was a disaster. And this lady was 25 years old and an art student. She said, I'm not a business person. And she kept panicking about everything that's going on. And it took me a while, three times, to say to her, what do you want? And eventually I got it out of her. She said, I just want to live in a condo by the beach. I want to do my art, and I'd like to work in a coffee shop a couple of days a week just to interact with people. I said, great, so that's what you want. So we'll take over all of this. We'll run it, modernize it, sell it, or liquidate it, but you need about $1.4 million in the bank throwing off about 10, 12% interest, where after taxes, you can live that life you want indefinitely. And then she said to me, what do I know about the newspaper business? I said, absolutely nothing, but what are the odds of me screwing this up versus you? She said, good point. So finding lost family members, people who have been adopted, who want to know where they came from or what their medical history is, that's all available now for a couple of $100 and a DNA test. And we had two requests last year to want to be the next U.S. president and figure out how to manage their social media campaign because they only had 1 million likes and Obama had 25 million. So what do I want? What do I want from my own concierge service? Well, I'm kind of liking this because I'm not bored anymore. I have the coolest fun job in the world with lots of different problems coming in. So all I want is to grow this. To do that, I need more IQ. I need more geniuses to come find us. Because our harvesting department that looks at the A's and F's in high schools is slow going. It's hard to find genius. 150 IQ, which is our minimum, is 1 in 10,000 people. Recruiting's hard normally, but that's really hard. So what if I had some mechanism where they could find us? Secondly, I need more people to know where, be aware that we're out there and there's somewhere they can take problems that are too complicated to solve on their own. And how do I grow the next generation of folks to study and work in technology and artificial intelligence so that we have a new generation of people to help the business grow? So I thought, well, I could write a book, but nobody reads anymore. I could do a movie, but I got to tell everything in 2 hours, and everyone will stop talking about the movie 6 months later. But I grew up watching The A-Team, Knight Rider, MacGyver, these shows. And those shows were a bunch of oddballs running around saving the world. I have to say, it's had an effect on me. So what if I did the same thing? What if we had a 10-year television show on the air showing examples of these things that we do every week, influencing the next generation, just like CSI influenced kids to study biology and chemistry, this would run them towards computer science and artificial intelligence. So we got the producers of Star Trek, Spider-Man, and Transformers, Kurtzman and Orsi. We got the director from Fast and the Furious that knows a little something about action. And then we partnered with the number one network in the world, CBS, studios and network, to put it on the air. This started airing in the US 5 weeks ago now. The premiere night got a total views of 19.2 million. The effect of the show has been huge. We used to get about 70 hits on our website a day. We're now at 104,000 per week. We used to get a new customer about once every 3 weeks. We now get about 3 an hour. We get about 20 resumes from geniuses every day that we're screening and interviewing and testing. And we're getting a huge number of requests. But also, we've really struck a chord with the fans in terms of mothers of smart kids, kids with ADHD, kids been thrown out of their third school, and the comments you see here are focusing on this EQ topic. People are really striking a chord where people are really opening up a conversation around this and bonding with their children every Monday, sitting down watching the show and explaining and having that discussion with each other. And the show is not about where we are now. It's rewinding us back to 4 or 5 guys in a garage that can't pay the rent because they're so dysfunctional and they don't know what's wrong with themselves. And they meet the first super nanny, the high EQ person, Catherine McPhee, who begins to teach them what appropriate means. And so you've got a dysfunctional family of superheroes that got nowhere else to go. And that seems to have made a show that people like. And as Tobias said, it'll start airing here on Friday on ITV. And I believe in Ireland, November or January. So I would say I agree with what Henry Ford said. Thinking is the hardest work there is, which is why so few people engage in it. Our model for how we work is we average $150 an hour. And that seems very low, but we got hungry minds to feed, and we're less about the money. So we have people cheaper than that, we have people more expensive than that. Once we divide up the project properly, that's what it averages. We have our own currency, Scorpion credits or tokens. You buy them in advance with a minimum amount of about $5,000. And then you just use them as needed, like our Rent-A-Brain vending machine. And you can quit out and cash out your chips anytime that you want, that any tokens you haven't used. That way, you fire us or hire us every week, depending on whether we're as good as we said we were. And it can start for a small consultation. So my challenge to you is check it out, Google it, go on concierge.com. And start typing in that stuff on your to-do list that you're never going to get around to. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Thank you so much, Walter. Walter's so kind. He's around for 2 days, and as he said in the beginning, he welcomes you to come and see him one-to-one occasions. Have a word with him. I think he's most interesting. the right occasions right now. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a morning break. Thank you.